Hey everybody, Stuart Macadam here, and super excited to have Stewart Gauld on the channel today. Stewart is the founder of Syndeo Media, a digital online marketing company based in the sunny Bay of Plenty here in New Zealand, but with clients all over the world. Stewart has helped dozens of businesses thrive online, both through his direct work with clients and also with his online brand, Stewart Gauld, which has a YouTube presence with more than 90,000 subscribers. He also has his website, stuartgauld.com, and I'm really looking forward to chatting to him about a whole range of topics today. So Stuart, welcome along to the show.
Yeah, thanks for having me, Stu.
Yeah, very
good. Same name, different spelling.
Exactly. Obviously, I've got the better spelling.
Oh, yeah. Who knows?
So you've been able to produce income which requires little to no work every single month of more than $10,000, which to a lot of people would be quite a substantial life-changing amount. Can you tell us a bit more about the work that's involved and required to get to that level, and also a bit more about the journey you've walked to get there?
Yeah, well, good question. $10,000 a month, residual is a lot of money. That's life-changing for anyone. And I think when the organization, my personal brand hit that, it was quite cool to see, because that was just, you know, semi-passive income coming in. And then on top of that, you know, we're doing all our other work, we're engaging with organizations, we're running our Syndeo Media, which is a digital media and marketing agency, as well as growing the personal brand. But kind of taking it a step back, so I first started with Syndeo Media, which again is a digital media and marketing agency, and the whole intention of that brand was to really just, you know, help small business owners transition online, helping them with establishing an online presence with a website, setting up their different social media channels, helping them with their marketing, whether it's Google Ads, it's Facebook Ads, PPC, different types of campaigns, different types of networks and channels. And so that agency started to grow, and we started helping more organizations. And then with that, I kind of wanted to move more into the educational side of digital media and marketing, whereas I found myself doing a lot of work for clients that was super easy to do, and they can really just do it themselves. They just didn't know how. So that kind of got me into starting to create actually YouTube videos, which were actually tutorials to begin with that I'd use to send to my clients for them to just do a lot of these small tasks themselves. It might be updating a post on social media, it might be making a change on their website, and I'd show them how to do that on a video. So that way they save money, I can leverage this video and just share it with all my clients that needed to make these small changes.
Thanks for joining me. Today I want to share how to create and add professional email signatures to Outlook and Gmail. So if you use Outlook or Gmail as your webmail service for your business, I'm going to show you how you can create a professional and compelling signature.
And as well, it kind of just started growing a bit more, started reaching more people all around the world with the channel and the personal brand. And when that started happening, we started seeing people reach out to us from all around the world, small businesses, plumbers, electricians, builders, dentists reaching out to us from the US, Australia, Canada, just wanting help with their website, with their online branding. And so that was quite cool to see that the YouTube videos, the tutorials, were reaching people organically all around the world. And then they'd reach out to us, and then would do little jobs for them, you know, so we're generating clients through YouTube organically. And then it started creating, we obviously got monetized, and it started generating quite high amounts of residual income through AdSense, which is basically just ads on your videos. And yeah, you get paid monthly, which is really cool. And that was just an additional income stream, which ended up growing quite quickly over the last 2 years. So it's quite cool with that personal brand, Stewart Gauld, the YouTube channel. We're able to reach a lot of small business owners around the world, help educate, help them upskill, and help them essentially thrive online. And while we're doing that, we're also getting paid by YouTube. And then obviously with the clients we're getting, we funnel those through to Syndeo Media, which is the agency. So that was kind of my my long answer for your short question.
Yeah. So for those that don't know as well, Stewart Gauld's mother is a teacher. So obviously he's got a pretty good grounding in education and communicating in a way that people can understand, you know, sometimes hard to use platforms and digital marketing tools. And Stuart does a great job on his YouTube channel of explaining it in a very simple way. One of the reasons why I think he's amassed more than 90,000 subscribers is because he provides very useful tutorials that are very relevant. Because the big video that really helped your YouTube channel explode was how to use Zoom at the start of 2020, when large parts of the world were going into lockdown and needed to do online meetings. Was that a video that you planned to do in advance, or was it something which came about from you seeing what was happening?
Yeah, so that actually was a spontaneous video because I saw the world just through online people talking about how people are now having to work from home. So Skype, Zoom, all these different communication platforms were starting to blow up. And I did a little bit of my own research, saw that Zoom was a highly searched keyword or keyword phrase, how to use Zoom. And so I actually got quite lucky with that because that helped the channel explode really quickly. Before that, I was creating about one or two videos every week for about a year and a bit, and saw slow but consistent growth as soon as that video came out, because there was a need for that video. People needed to know how to use Zoom, how to communicate online with their teams remotely. And so that just took the channel up to the next level. And then just through consistency and building the channel and continuing to provide the content that I knew people wanted to see, that my audience wanted to see, small business owners, just took off. So yeah, that was really the turning point for that channel, for the personal brand. So super grateful that YouTube took that video and ran with it, because that really took the channel to the next level.
How many subscribers and views and stuff were you getting before that?
So before that, it was a lot less. It was maybe, I can't remember the figure, but it might have been like it was starting to grow. So it's about 5 to 10 a day, maybe, if I was lucky. My subscribers were under 1,000. But I was starting to kind of pick up that momentum. And you can tell with analytics in YouTube, you can tell when, you know, your channel is starting to grow. And I think, that video, the Zoom video, just kind of took the channel to the next level. And and then the rest is history, really.
When we first met, something that was quite interesting is you were saying that you got quite a few leads for your business through YouTube.
Yeah.
And I'm looking at what a lot of online advertisers are doing now, and a lot of them are encouraging people to start YouTube channels and get leads through organic videos.
Yeah.
And here you are doing that back in 2019, when a lot of people were spending their time on Facebook and Instagram and Google ads trying to generate clients. Was that an opportunity that you saw as a good way of getting clients, or was that something that sort of goes back to what you were talking about with educating people, and then they would reach out to you if they needed additional help?
That's a really good question. So in the beginning, I didn't think about that. I was really just thinking about creating tutorials that I could then leverage and send to my clients that needed to do certain activities. But then as the channel started growing and I started getting emails and generating leads, I realized that, wow, this is the way to go, because I'm building authority, I'm building credibility, I'm becoming a market leader because I'm providing this education. I've got nothing to sell. I'm just providing education, and then people reach out to me because they know I can do it myself. They don't want to do it. They don't want to watch the tutorial, or they just don't have the skills or technical knowledge to do it themselves. So they'll reach out, and that would be a lead, and ultimately, hopefully, they'd convert into a customer. So that was when that started happening. I was like, oh wow, like, this is powerful stuff. You know, I'm creating content organically. I'm not putting any money or funds behind it to drive paid traffic. People are finding me, they're seeing that I'm a credible person in my industry, and they're reaching out to me for work. to get stuff done. So that whole journey kind of transformed over time. It started off as just tutorials to help my clients. Then I realized the potential in generating leads, and then it was sponsorships and generating income through AdSense. Mm-hmm. So it was kind of like a progression of the growth of the channel, realizing what was working and what wasn't working, and the potential of YouTube and creating content. Mm. Yeah.
And that's something which is very much underestimated these days. Even if you have a YouTube channel that is still in its early stages and still growing,
yeah,
it still doesn't hurt to have what's called affiliate links in the description box underneath. And that's something that you've been doing for quite a while, probably before the channel really took off and exploded by having affiliate links for HubSpot and a lot of other platforms, which even now are generating passive income for you as your audience has begun to grow upwards. Because at the time of recording, Stuart's knocking on the door of 100,000 subscribers on YouTube. And if you're watching this video in the future, he probably will have his little 100,000 subscribers placard, which is super exciting for you. And it's it really just shows the ability to influence people, especially when you focus on one particular platform, which is exactly what you've done. You haven't, until recently, stretched your wings out to other platforms like Facebook and Instagram, unless it's for clients, but specifically for your brand, your big focus has been just on YouTube.
Yeah.
And something that we've spoken about quite extensively off camera has been that lesson of delayed gratification, a harder today for an easier tomorrow.
Yeah.
And YouTube definitely involves a lot of patience, it involves a lot of research, it involves a lot of investment into creating content now.
It's time investment,
which may only pay off 2, 3, 4, 5 years down the track, and it's something that's worked incredibly well for you. Did you ever consider going onto other platforms earlier on and investing in that along with YouTube, or was it always just about focusing on just on YouTube?
Yeah, well, good question. I'll quickly just go back to a point you mentioned.
Sure.
Was having a small audience on YouTube or another platform and monetizing that. So you if you're thinking about starting a YouTube channel or another platform, you don't need a big following. You don't need a huge audience. You know, there's other ways to monetize your brand. And that's kind of what I did in the beginning. It was generating leads through those videos. There's also affiliate links, like you mentioned. And you only need a few clicks, a few leads per month to actually create a full-time income. So you don't need a huge brand. You just do not need a huge channel to actually start monetizing, creating a significant income. So if you're thinking about monetizing your small brand, you're thinking about starting a YouTube channel or another brand on another platform, then you don't need a huge audience. You can have a micro audience, a specific audience that follows you because of the value that you're offering. And there's so many different ways you can monetize that audience. Like Stuart said, through affiliates, through generating leads because you're providing educational content, sponsorships. There's so many ways you can monetize your brand. So micro brands do really well because they have such a niche audience. Kind of has so much respect and connection to that creator, to that brand. So going back to that point, you don't need a big brand, a big channel to start creating a significant monthly income. So going back to your question, which was I thinking about other platforms outside of YouTube? Yes, I was thinking about them, but I didn't get much traction on these other platforms purely because I was focusing on search. I wasn't creating engaging, kind of like binge-worthy content like some creators and brands do. It was purely education focused. It was purely for people searching for specific solutions to their problems. And that's where YouTube is such a good and powerful platform or search engine, because people jump on YouTube to search for help. You know, they have problems and they search for solutions on YouTube as well as on Google. And that's kind of what I saw in the beginning, and that's why I doubled down on YouTube rather than these other platforms. And yeah, and now we're just starting to focus more on blog content, so blogging, more articles, so just translating the videos into blog content so that people can find us across the internet on different search engines, not just YouTube, not just Google search.
Because that has been the project that you've been working very hard on, which is bringing out your website, stuartgauld.com. And that was a project which was many months in the making, and something which you and your team worked together on to bring out and sort of really connect with the world in a completely different sense. So rather than just having your YouTube channel and just being that your central point of people connecting with you and reaching out to you, you've now have your website where you can optimize for SEO, you can share content, share your videos, do consulting with businesses that do need that help and want to reach out to you. It really just provides you with another way of diversifying a little bit more, so that if YouTube were to say, come to you tomorrow and say, right, rather than you earning what you're currently making, we're going to take an extra 10, 20, 30%. So that way, you've kind of still got that extra leverage available, and you're not going into a bit of a panic and saying, oh my gosh, this has really impacted me. So I think it's quite clever that you have sort of gone down that avenue as well, because you're really creating that extra level of influence. You've also started to build a bit of an email list as well. How many emails have you currently got on your list?
Well, how many do I have? Not a whole bunch. I think I'm sitting on about 800 and something now. Yeah, 800 and something. Yeah, so I've recently started putting a bit more energy into that. Yeah, so that's going quite well. Stable growth. But again, I could probably put a lot more time into the email list. But yeah, again, going back to your question, I do kind of going back to what you're talking about, how I've transitioned into different channels, being, you know, the website and the YouTube channel. You really should focus on an omni approach, not just keep all your eggs in one basket. But also, I found that a lot of people preferred learning by reading rather than watching. So I'd have people commenting on videos saying, you know, do you have any articles about this? My mum, for example, she's like, I would prefer reading this content to learn so I can follow the steps rather than watching. So that kind of got me into the world of actually creating content. And it's, creating blog content, so translating the videos into written format. And that's been, going really well. People are responding really well to that. So it's all just realizing what your audience wants and how you can provide that value, that level of value to your audience. But the email list is, I'm trying to focus more on automation around that now. So creating kind of sequences, flows, putting those in place, and just, trying to split up and create segments of my email list for those that are interested in certain areas, because I cover so much on the different channels for small business owners. I'm trying to kind of figure out and analyze what my audience is truly interested in and when it comes to kind of, you know, thriving online and upskilling.
And it's quite interesting with your YouTube channel and also with your blog as well. A lot of it is geared towards that beginner level knowledge and getting people acquainted with different platforms and different tools that they need to thrive online. But you've had a couple of surprises as well with some of your videos that have really spiked quite, you know, substantially. And one that was quite interesting was platform called Jira, which is one that I'd never heard about before, and for some reason it just seems to have taken off one day, and that momentum just has carried it forward in a way that
it's true. It keeps going.
You know, it's really hard to comprehend how why that is, but a lot of people are latching onto it, and it's actually impossible as a digital marketer, I think, to predict people's behavior. You can create buyer personas. You can create pain points and gain points that they get from your product or service. But ultimately, if you're not testing it and putting it out there into the world, it's very hard to get a true gauge on what people are likely to respond to, because very often it's done on emotion. And if they look at a platform, it may even be down to like a particular color sequence and color colors that the platform uses,
yeah,
that may just resonate with them, yeah, and they're likely to go ahead with
exactly,
it.
Exactly, yeah.
And I've seen that with HubSpot versus a lot of other CRM software where people would go for HubSpot just because of the colors that they use.
Yeah.
And that's something which, when you're creating an online brand, which can go and produce you passive income or semi-passive income, that's something which obviously you put quite a bit of thought into as well, with thinking about what your customers want, but also as well creating a design that's very inviting.
Yeah.
So I suppose that's a very long-winded way of me asking you the next thing is, when you're creating a brand online, what do you need to look at including, and what do you need to give some very serious thought to?
Yeah, when you're considering getting started building a brand, whether it's a personal brand or just, you know, your, an organization, a brand, you've definitely got to listen to your audience. Like, for example, with the YouTube channel, Stewart Gauld Personal Brand, a lot of the videos that I've created on that is because of the tools or the activities that my clients currently do or the tools that they use. Sometimes I'll reach out to them, say, hey, can you give me a list of tools that you're currently using? Why do you use them? What's your favorite tool? And they give me an explanation or they'll send me a list. And that's kind of the basis of creating content and building my brand. So when you're thinking of starting a brand, you've got to know exactly what value you're offering to your audience. You've got to know exactly what your specialization is, what can you offer, because everyone has something to offer. And then you've got to know your audience. You've got to know exactly that that's the audience that wants your service, your product, that wants the information that you're providing. So it's really just finding out what you're good at, what you enjoy doing, especially if it's a personal brand, and then understanding your audience, listening to your audience. And that can be from not just what they want to see or hear, the content, the products, the services that you offer, but the way that you present, the way that you educate. So for example, the way that I create content and I kind of go through a tutorial or walk through a tutorial has changed based on what my audience wants. So the way that I speak has to slow down, the type of words that I'm talking about, just because my audience responds a lot better to certain words that I share within my tutorials. For example, if I say navigation, they love it when I talk about navigation, or I highlight the button and actually say what I'm clicking. So yeah, going back to kind of that question and answering that in really a sentence is just know what you have to offer and understand who your audience is, and that's it. Then you build your brand from that, and your brand will evolve over time based on your audience and based on what you have to offer.
So what's your key brand voice? If you were to put it into one or two sentences, what would you say your brand voice is?
So for the Stewart Gauld brand, my brand voice for me is really kind of what I focus on, which is just education. So I'm not selling anything. I'm trying not to push anything. It's just providing, is my focus is just to provide as much value as possible to my audience. I know what they want, I know what works well, and when I know that works well, they reach out to me for our services and I funnel them to through to Syndeo Media. But with Stewart Gauld, my brand voice I'm not too sure. I just create good content that people want to watch and hear, and it's I just focus on education.
So philosophy of educating every business owner on the planet, would that sort of be
a reflection of anyone
that uses marketing software?
So I guess if you're talking about the slogan for the brand, or what I'm trying to do, my vision with the brand is to really just equip small business owners with the tools, skills, and knowledge to help them thrive online. So it's really just equipping them with everything they need to thrive online themselves, to succeed online. You know, small business owners, local businesses, they do need to transition online. We've already seen with COVID, you have to be online in some form. And every business can transition an area of their business online in some form. They can change the way they offer their services, their marketing plan, their strategies. So that's been a big focus for that goal, is really just to help small business owners, yeah, really get updated with the online world and really, transition online. Yeah.
Mm. It's interesting you mentioned that, because I look at like my brand, which is Macadam Marketing, or my YouTube channel, which is just clocked over 600 subscribers. Woo! At the time we're talking. It took 5.5 months to go from 500 to 600. Yeah. But I think I'm not really so concerned with the quality, or the quantity, should I say, of the number of subscribers coming in, because a lot of those people that are joining up, yeah, are watching the videos and really engaging well with the content that's being put out, because the philosophy on my channel is to help people become masters, yeah, at Facebook advertising, yeah, Facebook content, and Facebook marketing as a whole.
And that's where you'll win long term, because you're focusing on helping. You're focusing on providing that value to your audience.
Mm.
Everything else follows.
Exactly. And like, you know, just for the Business Suite tutorial video that I did last year, it's generated more than 11,000 views. Mm. And that was basically a live recording where I went through just the very Billy basics of, yeah, it. And there were requests from people on certain features and how to add particular things. So this time around in 2022, when we're recording this, I am doing a full comprehensive walkthrough, yeah, of the Business Suite, particularly as it's rolling out across a lot of Facebook pages now, where when people want to post content and go to business.facebook.com, it's taking them to the Business Suite rather than to the business manager. So, yeah, getting people up to date on how to do things like navigate the Business Suite homepage, how to post content calendars, how to connect your Instagram account to the Business Suite. Those sorts of things, I think, are really going to help propel a lot of people into a more advanced stage where they're not confused.
Mm.
And even with testing different theories as well, because I think the biggest problem a lot of people have, Stuart, is one, there's so much information out there, and two, it's sold to people and pitched to people, yeah, particularly with YouTube ads that are going in front of videos by people who claim to be experts.
Yeah.
It's very hard to know what works and what doesn't. And one thing that we've done is we've reviewed a lot of courses, quite a few courses now from experts. And we've also tested a couple of theories as well that have been put forward by people. Things like pause and test versus continuous, long copy, short copy. And that's really captured a small but very niche market of people who are Facebook marketers or running their own ads, who have a real interest in that, as has the course reviews, which have taken on a life of their own.
Yeah,
because a lot of people want to go and upskill themselves and learn how to do particular things, but aren't sure who to look for. Yeah. So buying these courses and then reviewing them has been a real breath of fresh air for the account as well, because people are naturally skeptical about these people now. And if you go in as a Facebook marketer or just a digital marketer and review those courses, I think a lot of people are going to respond really well to that, because they've got someone who has got the experience with that, is that brand voice, and looks at those things.
Yeah, no, that's true. Yeah, and I think you're in a good position with that brand, with the channel as well, because you're focusing on Facebook at the moment. So you've got such a niche kind of audience at the moment. You're focusing on Facebook. You're focusing on those that need help with their different areas of Facebook. And that's really cool to see. So that will slowly grow, because you've just got that such a niche audience. And that's a micro brand you've got, which you can monetize. You're already monetizing through just building that authority, generating leads. And yeah, so it's really cool to see. So it's just it's just timing with a micro brand like that when you're so niche, just takes time before you start seeing that momentum.
And that's been one of the biggest things as well with the brand, is people have asked, can you talk to people that have done digital marketing in other ways? And that's why we're like doing this interview with the experts and talking with you about generating that passive income online, because it's something a lot of people are looking to people who have done it. But I think the thing that makes you so different, which is like really cool, is that you've never been one to go and gloat to others about your achievements. You've always continued to put in the work, put in the effort behind the scenes, and let the results speak for themselves, which is such a breath of fresh air, because you look at some of the people that are gloating really heavily right now, and you know, a couple of names that come to mind, Sophie Howard, Alaric Heck, Grant Cardone, people that have, you know, got a really large platform and have obviously done really well for themselves and discovered a good niche, but are really just gloating heavily about it. And I think it's throwing a lot of people off. So, you know, when you come onto like the channel here and share your knowledge and share your experience, I actually think that in itself is so much more valuable, because you're not going out there to sell courses to people or sell trainings or anything. You're giving a lot of that knowledge and information away for free.
Oh, exactly. And I think that's kind of the position I've always wanted to be in. I've just wanted to I'm not trying to sell anything. Like, if people need something, they'll come to you. And so my idea was always to just build that authority, build that credibility. And if people need that help, they need support, then they'll reach out. And I think that's just the most authentic and organic way to sell, is just to build that brand, just to educate. You know, Gary Vee talks about left jab, 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 and then right hook. I'm not even throwing the right hook. I just kind of want to naturally let people reach out if they need that support. And then you have loyal customers through that, because they know you have that credibility and authority. So yeah, it's I appreciate that. It's an awesome journey too. It's fun. I enjoy it.
And we'll put out a link to Stuart's assets online, his website, stuartgauld.com, and also to his YouTube channel as well. So you can check out some of the resources and materials that he has online.